Tonight on 8 out of 10 Cats Does Countdown, John Richardson, Sean Lott, Joe Wilkinson, Jade Adams, David Bedil, Susie Dent, and Rachel Riley. Now, welcome your host, Jimmy.
Welcome to 8 out of 10 Cats Does Countdown, a show about letters, numbers and conundrums. Did you know, for example, the word pension comes from an old Anglo-Saxon word for rent? Most people don't understand pensions, but they're really simple. Every Thursday, you put on a grey wig, dress up as your dead nan and collect her money from the post office. 40 is the number of minutes a cockroach can hold its breath, which explains why no-one's been able to successfully drown Piers Morgan. The Oxford English Dictionary grows by over 4,000 words a year. No wonder Susie Dent's worn out. Well, that and the dogging. Right, let's get started. OK, let's meet tonight's players. First up is Sean Lock.
Thank you.
Sean Lock is one of Britain's highest-profile comedians, and that profile has been built up over the years by Scotland Yard's serial killer task force. And joining Sean tonight is Joe Wilkinson. Joe Wilkinson has only two natural enemies, Velcro and the knit-nurse. Up against them this evening is John Richardson. Since getting married, John says he's learned the true meaning of love, whilst his wife has learned the true meaning of buyer's remorse. And John's teammate, Jade Adams. As well as being a comedian, Jade is also an opera singer. I love opera. It doesn't matter if you're rolling your eyes at the ceiling, stuffing cotton wool in your ears, or falling to your knees begging for it to stop. Opera is the perfect soundtrack. Right, John, here's a question for you. Are you a morning person or a sort of night owl? What would you say?
Well, we've just had a baby, so the mornings are horrific. And so are the nights. So there's about 10 minutes at about midnight that are all right, when I'm just down in that fourth whiskey. My wife goes to bed early. She goes about 9:30, and I pretend we don't drink during the week, because she doesn't. And it was becoming an issue in the marriage, so I just pretend I don't as well, and then she goes to bed about 9:30. I get shit-faced as quickly as I can.
Your wife goes to bed at 9:30. How boring are you at home?
It's more that we have an argument while we're watching telly, because she don't do it right.
Well, I'll stop you there. What does she not do right about?
Well, she'll ask me a question while the thing's on. Write it down and we'll talk after.
What kind of questions?
She'll say something like, oh, we went to a place like that, didn't we? And then I have to pause the telly to ask her what she said, cos I didn't hear, which she finds quite passive-aggressive. But I want to hear my wife, I love my wife, but I also want to hear what the Siddiquis have to say about what they've watched this week.
Jay, this is your first time on the show.
It is.
What do you think you're going to be better at, letters or numbers? What's your strong suit?
Well, I was just practising my mental arithmetic up in the dressing room. So
not the letters, then?
I'm going to be really great at both of them, because I'm nothing but enthusiastic about things that I'm not very good at, so...
It's like me and sex. Brilliant. You, John, can I ask, are you missing your baby daughter, and have you made Jade dress up as a child?
I like to dress like I'm a drag queen or a toddler.
It's weird, you've nailed both.
Thanks.
OK. Sean, tell us something about yourself that people might not know.
Well, OK, you ready for this? I'm the heir to the bird's custard fortune. My real name is Sean Bird's Custard. With a hyphen. It was too posh. I didn't like it, so I got rid of it. And then I felt a lot of people just were hanging around for the wrong reasons. I felt like, are these my friends? Or do they just... they just want some custard? That's a hard question to ask yourself when you're 28. So that's the main thing that people don't know about me. And I was the first person to do that with a baseball cap. It was my idea. I was at a keyhole. Thought, this is... and I realised ladies found it more intimate in lovemaking. So...
yeah, wow, that was a lovely innovation. Joe, what have you been up to recently?
Sitting about.
Anything else at all?
Oh, no, I just love it. I love sitting down so much that I actually don't mind getting bad news. Also, had to go to a wedding, though. That was a pain in the arse, wasn't it?
Whose wedding?
I don't know. little tip for you, Jimmy. Never tell a bride with a bit of dog shit on her dress to chillax. They get annoyed, especially when they find out as you threw it at her. but in my defence, we'd run out of confetti. I had to improvise.
Sean, have you got a mascot?
I do, Jimmy. You know, everyone enjoys a coffee table book, something that they can pore over any time they want.
Sure.
You know, something special, something beautifully made. And I've come up with a beautiful coffee table book. And you know the expression, fit as a butcher's dog?
Yes.
Mm. I thought, what about a baker's dog? So this book's called Fit as a Baker's Dog. And it features, you know, some dogs who, through the sympathetic look in their eyes, they can wheedle a snack out of the most hard-hearted of owners. So that's Buttercup. Oh, here's Trigger. Trigger. Now, a lot of people would say that Trigger is fat or obese.
What?
But no, she just likes big bones. That's Duke.
Oh, he's great. Look at him.
Is Duke a dog or a seal?
Duke, actually, he's a bit of a record holder.
Really?
He hasn't had a crap for 9 months. And then I thought, well, why not expand the book?
That looks like a flamingo that's let itself go.
Oh, here's Poppy. You wouldn't think carrots could do that to a rabbit.
Oh. Oh, my God.
Here's Harley.
Excellent.
The only way he'd catch a mouse is if he landed on it.
Can this be the rest of the show?
Yeah. Everyone's favourite. It's Rusty!
And will this be in all good bookstores?
Everyone. Every single place you can imagine. Railway stations. We're going to also drop them into war zones. Just to make people go, yeah, what are we doing?
Sean's mascot, everyone.
Thank you.
John, have you got a mascot?
Yes. It's a coping strategy, really. Life's very stressful, isn't it? And if you get annoyed as much as I do by people and the things they do, it's nice to have a way of getting that out. So at the end of every week, what I do is I purge myself of all the things that have upset me, and I thought you could watch me do it live.
Ooh.
So what you've got to do is you take the things that have worried you or upset you and you write them down on a piece of paper, and then you get rid of it. So this first one is for the woman I kept smiling at on the train. I was having a good old stare at her and I thought I knew her, and then I realised it's just that I saw her when I got on the train. And then when I looked back, I remembered seeing her the first time. And I think she thought I was going to kill her, but... You just swallow the stress down. I've given it a physical form. Well, you truly want.
And this is helping you cope with that disappointment?
That's gone now. That's gone. this is the uncredited park. I did a really good reverse park this week and my wife didn't say a fucking thing. Some of them are unfortunately too toxic to have inside me. So this is car phone guy. This is a guy on the M5 who I was overtaking because I drive like sometimes 60, 65. I'm going past this guy. I can see he's on his mobile.
Oh.
Giving it that. Dangerous. Pulled in behind him. Little flash of the old full beam. Just let him know I'm there. I know what he's up to. Go past him, think, how are you going to have a phone conversation with my horn on full blast? Drive on a bit, realise it's a foreign car, he's just a passenger. Goodbye, car phone guy. And he's gone.
Jade, have you got a mascot?
I bought a box. I used to be a freestyle disco dancer.
Yeah, sure.
I was. I did it for 12 years. I wasn't great at it. My sibling was. But I asked my mum for the box of trophies that I knew that she had in the attic, which were basically about 100 ninth place trophies that they gave me to stop me from having a tantrum because I didn't win. And I asked her for this box and she said, all right, I'll send it up. So she sent it up and I opened the box and I'm confused because there are all these big trophies in there, like just lots of them. And I don't actually remember winning any of these trophies. And what it turns out is that my mother has sent me my siblings' trophies of when she won everything. And then I asked her what happened to my trophies and she said, we threw them out.
Nice. Joe, have you got a mascot?
Yeah, I've bought one in my collection of Countdown indoor tropical water features. So there's all of us on here having a nice time. There's Sean. See Sean there? he's having a lovely time shouting at a pigeon. John on holiday, yeah. he's slightly more body conscious than Sean. So he's wearing a T-shirt with no trousers and pants on. And that's the only one that's life-size. then here, we've got me, Susie and Rachel having a lovely time. And as you can see, Rachel's passed out on the back because she's been drinking all afternoon. And then, finally, we've got Jimmy here, lounging. Having a lovely time on a cocktail. Don't know why he's so happy. Absolutely no genitals. And the best bit about it, my favourite bit, is it's not actually water. It's Campari and lemonade. So, yeah.
Okay, fine. What a feature. Beautiful. Okay, over in Dictionary Corner, it's David Baddiel. David's latest book won an award for Best Laugh Out Loud Book for 9 to 13-year-olds. I mean, it was aimed at adults, but still. David, you've got two kids. What kind of a parent are you?
I'm all right. I brought along a picture of my daughter, Dolly. That's her a few years ago wearing her lovely cute panda hat. And it's an interesting thing, actually, because people, when they're on the telly, they don't normally bring along pictures of their kids because they think, like, the press might get hold of it. That represents some kind of intrusion. But I'm more worried the press might get hold of some pictures of me doing some bad parenting. For example, forcing Dolly to pull her lovely cute panda hat over her face and then adjusting her hair so that she looks like Hitler.
Yeah, but that is, I mean, that's questionable in any household. In a Jewish household, it's really.
Well, that's part of the thrill of it, really, for me. it is weird sometimes being a bit well-known. Like, when she was three, she used to call me Daddy, obviously, but she would also sometimes hear people calling me David. So sometimes she'd call me David. And then once, I was taking her for a walk in the park, and she had to go for a wee. And I went into the men's toilet. I sort of pushed past all these men who were in there, got her into the cubicle. That's the moment she chose to go, David Baddiel. And I could feel all the men outside thinking, that's not her father.
OK. I'm with David, of course. It's Susie Dent.
Susie Dent.
Susie Dent knows the derivations of even the rudest words and phrases, so where does cock gobbler come from? Well, she was born in Woking, but now she lives in Oxford. My baby, that's my baby, huh?
You're always banging that door, aren't you?
Are you talking to Susie or me now?
He's never banging on my door, I have to say, thank goodness.
Susie, you often post a word of the day on Twitter. What's your word for the day?
Crimble is quite nice.
Crimble?
Crimble is to cringe into yourself, shrink into yourself and try to sneak past someone unnoticed. And, John, do you know what? One of my favourite words, which we use a lot at home, is a scurry funge.
A who now?
Scurry funge is that manic kind of tidying that you do just before visitors arrive. But you probably never scurry funge, do you?
No, I never have visitors.
And in charge of the numbers, it's Rachel Riley. Where would we be without Rachel Riley? Well, we could probably just move the letters board closer to Susie. It's not like she's rushed off her feet. Rachel, who do you think here would be the best person to help you survive a zombie apocalypse?
Well, apparently one of the ways you can get rid of them is by pretending to be a zombie, so obviously Joe.
I'd have been a little hurt if you hadn't chosen me.
OK, the prize the teams will be competing for tonight is this, the Countdown Trumpet. OK, let's count down, everyone. Time for the first game. Sean and Joe, you get to pick the letters.
Good evening. May I have a vowel?
You may. Thank you, Joe.
Please.
I.
The other one. The other one, the longer one.
Yep. G.
And then a consonant.
D.
And then a vowel, please.
E.
Consonant, please.
S.
And then an H. Then a vowel, please.
I.
This is horse shit.
Can you take over?
Would you mind?
OK, watch this. Like a consonant, please, Rachel.
L.
Oh, much better.
Yeah. And another vowel, please.
And the last one, O.
And for the first time today, here's the countdown clock. Bloody done a hamstring. How many, John?
Seven.
Jade, how many?
Five.
Sean, how many?
Five.
Joe?
Tough one.
Seven.
Sorry, Joe?
Do you want to start that in?
Jade, you're five.
I don't even know if it's a word.
It's okay, Jade, it's okay. Just what?
I want it to be a word so badly.
What is it?
Guilts.
Yeah, guilt.
Yeah, that's a word.
Oh, thank God.
Sean, you're five.
Toils.
John, you're seven.
Are we not going to Joe?
Well, he'll get there.
I sort of feel it's easier for him to get there if I give him a wrong.
Probably is, yeah. Go on, what have you got, though?
Toggles.
Ooh, that is weird.
Toggles.
Absolutely mental. Have you spelt it, Abby?
Joe, did you get anything at all?
Oh, shut up. I had till.
Are you spelling till?
T-I-double-L. There's only one L. There's one L.
I saw 7 points to John. But deal and dent, could they have done any better?
We had toggles as well, and we had a word that describes your inner soul, which was oiliest.
I'm thrilled you think I have a soul. So at the end of that, John and Jade are in the lead with seven.
Yes, ma'am.
OK, on to our first numbers round. All right, John and Jade, your turn to pick the numbers.
Can I have three big'uns and
Three small ones, please,
what?
Babe.
This was a shot. What? Yes, you oh, can, Dave. What you like. All right, little ones are 9, oh. 10,
uh-oh.
And 7.
Aye.
Big ones, 75, oh. 50, and 25.
Oh, I'm going to be rubbish.
And the target, 219. Oh.
OK, and your time starts now. So the target was 219. Did you get it, Jade?
No.
What did you get?
I panicked and I just wrote loads of 50s on the bit of paper and then...
She has written 550s down there.
I was in the bottom set for maths at school, so this is gonna... You know, we've got a couple of other rounds of this, right? Yep.
Was your sister any good?
OK, did you get it, John?
I got it, mate.
You got it. OK, Sean, do you get it?
I got 218.
Mm. OK, close. Joe, I presume you got it?
Yeah.
How did you get it, Joe?
No, there's no 15 there.
If you did 25 yeah, minus 10, does that help?
There's no pie.
OK, John, how did you do it?
75 over 25.
What?
Piece of genius. 3.
Times 7.
Can't use magic, mate. 20.
Times 10.
210.
And add 9.
Very nice. So
is that real? Is that real?
It's not a real thing. It's not a real thing. So the scores at the moment, Sean and Joe are on no points. John and Jade have 17. And here is your teaser. The words are knob curse. The clue is you don't want to be hit by one. That's knob curse. You don't want to be hit by one. See you after the break. Welcome back. The answer to the teaser, the words were knob curse. The clue was you don't want to get hit by one. It was, of course, bouncers. So John and Jade are in the lead. OK, they've been playing in teams so far, but this game is just for Sean and Jade.
Yes.
So, Jade, your turn to choose the letters.
Can I have a consonant, please, Rachel?
Thank you, Jade.
D. And a vowel.
I.
And a consonant.
Y.
And two vowels.
U and E.
And then a consonant.
R.
And then another consonant.
B.
And a vowel.
A.
And then a consonant.
And the last one.
S.
And your time starts now. For fuck's sake. It's Pat Sharp. It's Pat off Sharp. The 80s, everyone. Hang on. What? Jade, what have you got?
I hope I got 6.
You got 6, okay. Sean?
7.
Yes.
Shit.
Jade, you're 6.
Rubies, R-U-B-I-E-S.
Yeah.
Sean, you're 7.
Bruised.
Oh,
bruised. Do that. 7 points to Sean. David, Susie, could they have done any better?
We've got a 7-letter word of seabird.
Seabird was as good as they could do. Excellent. OK, so at the end of that, Sean and Joe have 7. John and Jade have 17. Right. Now it's time for John and Joe to go head-to-head. Joe, your turn to pick the numbers.
Could I have the normal way? You know, the big one, big one, and then five little ones. Preferably 100, a 10, and a 1.
Oh, well, I'll see you up with
just
one big one.
Just have a look what's underneath. No.
I've picked one of the ones you wanted, so hopefully you'll be happy with that.
Well, I'm okay. Screwed then.
Let's have a look. Four.
Four.
Your best one. Chance is to get it straight away, then pull his jumper over
three.
His head.
Three. Six. And 50.
Write them down.
Oh, what do you mean, write them down?
127, your time starts.
You haven't got
now.
100, Joe. There's no 100.
Oh, yeah.
John, did you get it?
Yes.
Joe, did you get it?
Yeah.
John, how did you do it?
Very similar to Joe, I imagine. Perhaps we do it one stage at a time together.
Go on then, happy to do it, mate. I'll start.
Yes.
Three times?
No.
No.
Why did you say that? Why did you say I'll start?
I assumed. It started with 3 times 50. What else would you do? There's no 100!
Well, it's not. You still. There's still a chance. What's 3 times 7?
Keep going, Joe. What's
3 times
7?
What's 3 times 7?
You've already used the 3.
I've used the 3, mate. 4 times 7. 4 times 7 is.
28.
28.
Take that off.
Take that off. Plus. The five.
What numbers haven't we used?
6 and 1.
6 and 1. 6 minus 1. 5. Yes. That happened.
Did you get it?
Yeah, I did it the same as Joe, and you can't check, so I'll just...
OK, well, 10 points for both teams. Well, time now to go across to Dictionary Corner. David Badil, what have you got for us?
Well, I've got something quite interesting. It's this. It's called Bills of Mortality. Now, these are real things. They were published every week in London in the 17th century, and they are lists of what people died of that week in London. So I'm just going to take you through couple of weeks of those. Here's a real one. The diseases and casualties this week. Abortive, 5. Aged, 43. Burnt in his bed by a candle at St Giles Cripplegate. Two people died of cough that week. It's quite hard to do that now, isn't it? I would say unless it's a really big wretch. And three people died because they were frightened. Killed by a fall from the belfry at Al Hallows the Great. 1. It was a terrible week for the church, wasn't it? One person died of lethargy. One person sat around so much that they died. 11 people died of rising of the lights. They were on the rig at a Metallica gig. I don't know how that happened. And one person died suddenly. Here's another week. One person died of sore leg. Really, that's hard to do. It's a bad week for St Giles Cripplegate again. In a brewer's mash at St Giles Cripplegate. Three people died of Quincy, which was a cop show that was on in the 80s. One person died because they were distracted. Oi, mate, what is it? Here's the last one I could find of these. The diseases and casualties this week again. 10 died of cancer and wolf. It's a bad day, isn't it? When you've got cancer, then you get eaten by a wolf. I mean, really. 7 were overlaid. That's the way I'd like to go. And 46 were killed by several accidents. So they fell off the belfry. They they burned in their bed, they were eaten by a wolf, finally they fucking died. But my favourite in all of these lists, all I've seen, is the one person who managed to die of fucking piles. How is that possible? What, an enormous pile came out of his arse and suffocated him? So there you are, bills of mortality, this week's Dictionary Corner.
I love it. David Baddiel, everyone. Good. So the scores at the moment are Sean and Joe are on 17, John and Jade are on 27. And here is your teaser. The words are tug on nip. The clue is put your hands where I can see them. That's tug on nip, put your hands where I can see them. See you after the break. Welcome back. The answer to the tease, the words were tug on nip. The clue was put your hands where I can see him. It was, of course, gunpoint. OK, before we go on, a chance for our teams to win some bonus points. We're going to test their knowledge of unusual words for parts of the human body. So, John, Joe, join me at the podium. Let's play Show Me Where It Hurts. OK, I'm going to give you some historical words for body parts. All you've got to do is tell me where they are by sticking them on Fabio or Raoul. OK, here's your first word. If you had a wart on your periwinky, where would it be? There you go, gents. There's the word. Stick it where you think it would be. Your periwinky. OK, Joe, you've gone for the thigh. John, you've gone for the eyebrow. Well, I can tell you it's an old Scottish word for the little finger or the toe, so... nil poir.
So sorry.
Next, gentlemen, you're looking for the prat. So just pop that on your...
I've actually attached it to two different bits of it. Why off, mate?
John, you've gone for the ankle.
I'm just sort of trying to avoid hair.
OK, Joe, you've gone for the...
right testicle and the tip of the penis.
I can tell you it's a 16th century word for the buttock.
Ah! Wrong side!
Never mind. OK, next. If you had a pain in the arse ropes, show me where it would hurt. Where are your arse ropes? Sure, sure. So John's gone for the hamstrings and Joe's gone for...
straight to the anus.
I can tell you arse ropes are in fact the intestines, so no points there. Last one. So you're looking for the bibble chunk. So if you had a pain in your bibble chunks, where would that be? What would hurt? Show me where it hurts, boys. Sure. His hairy neck. So Joe's gone for the neck.
Whatever that muscle there is called. I've never seen one, really.
Well, I can tell you it's a slang term for breasts, so John gets the point. That means John got the most right, so that's 5 points for John's team. Thanks for playing Show Me Where It Hurts. OK, on with the game. Sean and Joe, your turn to choose the letters.
Can that consonant, please?
R.
And then a vowel, please.
E.
Oh, that's good.
And then I'll let young Joe have a bash.
Consonant.
T.
And another
one. Go on, knock yourself out.
C.
And I'll have a vowel, please.
That's exactly what I'm going for.
It's going well.
And then a consonant.
Yes.
S.
Yes. I'll have a vowel. No hesitation.
I.
And a consonant.
P.
Fuck it. What? I need a certain letter, otherwise I'm out.
And what would you go for at this juncture?
I've just seen the consonant.
Is it a T?
Rachel.
I'd go for a consonant.
OK, we'll have a consonant then.
D.
That's not a T.
OK, your time starts now.
Oh,
OK, Sean, how many?
Seven.
Seven. Joe?
I've got three.
You've got a three. A safe three.
I'm going to throw it out there. It's not a word.
You've got a three and it may not be a word.
It's not
John.
A word. I know it's not a word.
John, how many did you get?
I'll try an eight.
Jade?
Six.
Six. OK. Joe, you're three...
Eds.
Eds.
As in a few Edwards.
Eds. Now, as in
remember,
a few
you
Edwards.
Couldn't have, you couldn't Eds. Have names.
Susie's looking.
No.
I'm out of game.
I'm not
I?
Out of abbreviations.
No, OK. Jade, you're six.
Oh. Hurts. P-E-A-R-T-S.
Without the S, it's an adjective meaning lively or cheerful.
So, so you fall now.
Are you stepping to Jade? Are you saying, if you want to throw down and fight, I'm.
are you trying to get a fight, like a fist fight?
Sort? Ideally, yeah.
Yeah, okay. are you turned on by the idea of Susie fighting?
No.
I thought because you insult her every week.
Yeah.
So if you were, you could just let her have one straight punch to your face.
Yes.
Sure.
Just a slap. Like a big. I mean, a slap.
No, not a slap.
Or just push him off something.
If it was a slap, I mean, I think a slap's a good idea. I'm not sure about the whole face element of this.
What about a claw hammer across the knee?
Okay. Sean, what's your seven?
Aspired.
Lovely stuff.
Oh, nice. Very nice.
OK, John, you're eight.
Well, it's crappiest. There's only one P.
Yeah, it's me two P's, definitely.
7 points to Sean.
Yeah! Sean and Joe!
What's that? Sorry.
No, 7 points to Sean and Joe.
Apologies. 7 points to Sean and Joe.
Thank you.
Yeah. But I'd just like to say, Joe there was saying it's about Sean and Joe. You know, when we score points, we do it together. Mm-hmm. And very much, Joe was very much assisting me in getting that seven because I knew he'd get fuck all. That really gave me the motivation to try. So I'd like to thank you for that.
We're a team. David, Susie, could they have done any better?
We've got a nine-letter word.
Huge.
Which, huge. Which is?
Practiced.
Susie Dent. OK, so at the end of that, John and Jade have 32, Sean and Joe have 24. OK, time to go across again to Victory Corner. David Badil, what have you got for us?
I wanted to try a little experiment, if that's possible, Jimmy. Now, like some comedians, I sometimes put jokes on Twitter. Here's a few examples of those. Here's Vladimir Putin at 14, which is obviously not the joke in itself, but I was moved to retweet that using the words Macaulay Stalin. Now, that got these numbers here. That's what I want to draw your attention. 146 retweets, 214 favourites. And I think if you're a comedian putting jokes on Twitter, these numbers operate as a kind of virtual laugh. Like, the bigger the number, the bigger the laugh, right? That's sure. A kind of medium-sized laugh on Twitter. It got a kind of medium-sized laugh in the room. But let's see if we can do any better with this. This is a picture of Kim Jong-un. Again, not the joke in itself, but you may remember Kim Jong-un went missing a little while back. Do you remember that? And when he came back, I posted, so that's where Kim Jong-un went, to the DFS sale to buy a miniature black leather sofa. to wear on his head. And as you can see, that got 270 retweets, 237 favourites, a slightly bigger laugh on Twitter, a slightly bigger laugh in the room. I mean, I should say that most of these jokes are not about dictators. That's just a weird coincidence. Most of them are just at my own expense. For example, this one, which... this is just a picture of me with Alan Yentob, Salman Rushdie and Alexei Sailor at a book launch. It hardly needs a caption, but I gave it one. It was the Who Can Look Most Like a Semitic Proclaimers competition. Eventually came down to two very strong teams. You can see the teams squaring up to each other there. That got 221 retweets, 434 favourites, so we're building the laugh as we go. So the one that I did of these kind of jokes that got the most retweets and the most favourites I've ever got on Twitter was a couple of years ago now. It was when Andy Murray won Wimbledon. There was this picture of Andy Murray the first time when he won Wimbledon with the respective party leaders at the time. And I just posted that I thought Andy was saying, no, really, you're all 2,090 retweets. 821 favourites. The lesson there, really, Jimmy, is keep it simple.
David Vadim, everyone. And here is your final teaser. The words are sex pilot. The clue is ready for adventure. That's sex pilot, ready for adventure. See you after the break. Welcome back. The answer to the tease, the words were sex pilot. The clue was ready for an adventure. It was, of course, exploits. OK, time for our final letters game. John and Jade, your turn to choose the letters.
I'd like a consonant, please, Rachel.
T.
I'd like a vowel, please.
U.
Consonant, please.
P.
I've got a three.
Consonant, please.
L.
Vowel, please.
E.
Consonant, please.
Tuple. R.
Consonant, please.
M.
Vowel, please.
O.
Consonant, please.
L.
OK, and your time starts now. Go on, Lily. You got it? This is amazing. I've never felt so comfortable. I finally feel like me. Goodbye, Jimmy. Hello, Gemma.
Why has he got a pair of socks down there?
Yeah, that's where the effects budget goes. Okay, John, how many?
Six.
Jade, how many?
Six.
You don't look happy with your six. Is it a real six?
I don't know whether it's a real word or it's a word that I say because I'm Bristolian.
Okay, Joe.
I've got a six that isn't a word.
You got a six that isn't a word.
Right, Mark, I've got a six that's a word.
You got a six that's a word. Okay, Jade, what have you got?
Puller.
Puller.
Ear. Why don't you pull her? I had lumper as well, which was ear. Why don't you lump her?
Lumper or puller? Either of those words?
Yeah, puller. Puller is a word.
Yes.
It means someone who pulls.
Yes. I smashed it. I smashed it.
You've smashed it. You've absolutely smashed it. Joe, your six.
Polar.
Polar.
That's probably a word. Let's just move on.
Yes, let's move on.
Oh, crap.
John, what was your six?
Mullet.
And Sean, your six?
You've got a nice one.
Pull it.
Yeah.
Yeah, nice. OK, so 6 points for both teams. Badil and Dent.
Oh, yeah, we got an eight letter. Oh, it's a polluter.
Polluter. So the scores at the moment, Sean and Joe have 30, John and Jade have 38. OK, fingers on buzzers. Time for today's crucial countdown conundrum. You ready? OK, all to play for here. OK, your time starts now.
I don't think it is one. Don't think it is one. That's not the numbers. Sometimes it don't just add up.
I can tell you that Joe's correct. There isn't a conundrum. Yeah.
What a shame.
OK, I'm going to restart the clock.
Oh! A hole!
Sean, you got it?
Yeah!
This is a great
OK,
day.
Sean's got it. Sean is...
Tis.
Yeah.
Tis.
Testimony!
Testimony!
Testimony! Yes!
Come on!
Give it a final scores are John and Jade have 38, Sean and Joe are the winners with 40 points. Congratulations, you're now the proud owner of this, the Countdown Trumpet. Thanks to all our panellists, our wonderful studio audience, and to all of you watching at home. That's it from us. Good night.
Jump a mountain in Austria and a brand new bunch of celebs, including a Sir. Sunday, 7:30, Channel 4, we launch. 9 o'clock tomorrow night, Big Film Prem, Seth MacFarlane's comedy western, A Million Ways to Die in the West. Ted's in it. Just kidding. Last leg up next, Russell Brand Live. Risky.